So here we are testing whether there exists any difference. If the difference exists, is it significant? So all these tests are actually called as tests for significance. So we are in a situation which is this. So but you are suspecting that that is not the case. Your mu 1 has come down from mu 2, or it is greater than that, or you can simply say that it is not the case. It is just not equal. Okay. So in this case, in order to prove this particular statement, now what you do is you have two populations, population 1, population 2. So you will select sample 1, you will select sample 2. And since I say it is large sample test, first, since there are two samples, now I'll use the notation N1 and N2 to indicate the samples. So I have selected N1 items from first population, N2 items from the second population, where both N1 and N2 are strictly more than 30. Then from this sample, you can talk about X1 bar. From this sample, you can obtain your X2 bar. And if you know the population variance, then you have the values of those standard deviations, sigma 1, sigma 2. If they are unknown, use the sample and obtain the standard deviation S1 and S2, which is square root of sigma x minus x1 bar whole square by n minus 1, square root of sigma x minus x bar whole square by n2 minus 1. So the formula remains the same, only change in the notation. And now using these values, we can come up with a test statistic. So it is just an extension, and we are using the result that sum of the normal distribution is also a normal distribution. Sum of normal distribution is also a normal distribution. So this follows again normal distribution with mean 0 and 1. So generally we write this like this. If you actually have some theta here, then you will talk about this minus theta there. So which is not case, but usually if I write here, we are assuming that we are checking for equality. If theta is 0, then the test is for equality. If theta is non-zero, then the test is for the difference. That is the second test here. So you will substitute your values, x1 bar, x2 bar, sigma 1 square, sigma 2 square. As said, if you don't know the values of population variance, you are using the sample variance, s1 square, s2 square, you will evaluate. So when you substitute the values, you will get some answer, which I call as z-cal. Now, whether it is one tail test, two tail test, or right tail test, you take the decision, compare it to the values, and observe whether you reject the hypothesis or accept the hypothesis. So those cases remain the same. As said, the only things which vary is what is your hypothesis, what is the test statistic, and in all the Z case, the decision is very much same. For a left tail test, you will observe whether your Z-cal is less than minus K. If it is actually less than minus K, you will reject the null hypothesis. If your alternative is greater than form, then your test is called as a right tail test. Here, you will reject the null hypothesis if your observed value or the calculated value is above plus K. If it is a two tail test, you will reject the null hypothesis. Your calculated value is below minus K or above plus K. So this is the procedure. Now, our normal distribution is defined such that if you look into the value of mean x bar, that is normal, and this happens irrespective of population to be normal or non-normal. So that's why we say select a large sample, and you can proceed even if you are not checking whether the normality assumption is, you know, valid or not, because the theorem is proved that in most of the cases, you can always see the normality for the sample mean. But if you select a small sample, now always selecting a large sample is not possible. So in that case, what we do is we select a small sample, because you know a disease is very rare. You cannot extract required number of samples. When you say 1 in 100 or 1 in 1,000 is the situation, then observing 9, 8, 5 cases itself is very large. So in that case, you cannot practically talk about selecting 30 observations. So in that case, we say the tests are small sample tests, so strictly less than 30. We say 30, but even if you have n is equal to 6, 8 or 10 or 15, any value, it need not be only 30. The beauty of this test is that even if you talk about a large case, the test gives you good results. And how or why is that? That is theoretically because if your x is normal, x bar is normal if n is large, but x bar is t, that means a function of x bar is t if n is small. This is not the reason, but the actual reason there is sigma is unknown. And this happens whenever we have this case, and therefore we use this distribution, which is called as p-distribution, and therefore small sample tests are called as p-test. What is p? P is a distribution which is closely associated to normal distribution, and it shares almost the same properties of normal distribution, and t is based on what's called as degrees of freedom, which is number of variables used in constructing the distribution. And whenever we are using the hypothesis testing, we say the hypothesis, the test statistic follows n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So you have to look in the degrees of freedom in order to obtain the table values. Again, we talk about three important tests here. T-test for single population mean, why this t becomes z, because as our degrees of freedom n becomes very large and large, p distribution becomes standard normal distribution. So for any n which is actually more than 30, if you are performing t test, it is actually a z test. The procedure becomes almost similar to what we have discussed in the previous case. Therefore, most of the people who are testing for mean, they prefer t-test, because even in the large case, it automatically becomes z-test. So you need not worry about this. So that's why the hypothesis testing for small sample case is, very widely used. You're testing two population mean, you're testing for any equality of two population mean, different population, but you can also apply this for a case where your population is nothing but same. So you are talking about two population means, but in a case where two samples from same population, or I could say population items, that's what this, and this is called as paired t-test, because you will talk about pairs of observations. In the previous case here, we'll take N1 from sample 1, population 1, N2 from population 2. Can have a case where N1 is equal to N2, but here we will be talking about pair of observations selected, and the test is called as a paired t-test, and this is the most widely used test in looking into effectiveness of tests, or if you have gone through some medication, some tuition, some special courses, revision classes, whether they have actually helped you. In those cases, you will be talking about mean before the treatment, mean after the treatment. So if you want to prove that your treatment is successful, your treatment could be anything, a particular pill, an exercise, a yoga, or it could be a tuition, a special class, a coaching class. Their treatment, if you want to prove that the treatment is effective, you should observe significant change in the sample mean after the treatment. And that significance change could be below, it could be above. And in the cases where I want to talk about, say, now a particular drug has, you know, makes the platelets go above a particular threshold level, then you are looking into a case where mu 1 is less than mu 2. So before the treatment, platelet count was less. After the treatment, the platelet count has gone up. So after me, it is this. So you're talking about a left tail test. You are in a situation where you want to prove that yoga or a particular pill actually reduces the blood pressure. Then before giving the pill, you are observing high blood pressure. After giving the pill, you are observing low blood pressure. So this is your alternative hypothesis. So your objective actually helps you in writing the alternative hypothesis. And the procedures of the first two are almost same. And you can get problems from this section. Small sample test, three tests are there. And out of this, there will be one problem from section one, one problem from section three, where we end the single test. We'll talk about test for single population mean, three tests for single population mean. Now the situation, background work is saying, you have a larger population, you are suspecting the value of mu in order to prove that you are selecting the sample, but because of some reasons, you cannot expect large sample, your sample is very much small. The process is very much simpler. You will have what called as null hypothesis, alternative hypothesis, test statistic, then you will talk about the decision. So here you are telling that your mu, look A is now taken over. So my mu is actually equal to some quantity, let me say theta, and you are telling that no, it has changed from theta. And then this case, we write the test statistic as P is equal to X bar minus whatever the value you have assumed to be mu divided by S by root N minus 1. And this follows distribution, which is called as P, with alpha level of significance and N minus 1 degrees of freedom. Now this T curve, as said, it is similar to your normal distribution, but it is a bit leptocartic. So the peak is, you know, somewhat sharp compared to normal, and the tails are thick compared to normal. So you will actually observe some, you know, very high values or high probability in the tail also. Whereas in case of normal, the curve is not that sharp or flat, but your tail probability is very much zero. So within 3 or around 3 only, your tail looks like it is touching x-axis. But in case of T, around 3, 5, 8 also, you will observe some gap between the tail and the x-axis. This is why, this is what our T curve is. And our N becomes larger and larger, T becomes, you know, similar to our normal curve. Now the decision making is same. So if you're talking about a left tail test, so you have case one, if your alternative is mu less than theta, which we call as left tail test, in that case, you are suspecting your value to be on the left part of our, okay. So you can get this from the T table, and in your cases, it will be given in the question, but will not give you exactly the required value. Two or three such values will be given. You have to select which is the correct value, and that is based on this called as degrees of freedom. So you have to correctly compute the degrees of freedom, and in this test it is N minus 1. So if I have given 10 values, 10x values, then the degrees of freedom is 9. So check the question where your p value is given for 9, select that one and conclude your test. So if you are calculated, so let me call this as calculated value of p, p cal. So if p cal is less than minus k, reject h naught. If your p cal is greater than k, sorry, in case of the other. Okay, so this is about the left tail, and this is how the decision is made. Now second case is right tail test. If you are actually talking about an alternative hypothesis, which is of the form mu greater than theta, then you will observe the critical region to be this part, which is plus k, and reject H naught if your calculated value of T is greater than K. And third one, a two-tailed test. So if your H1 is mu not equal to theta, which is two-tailed, in this case, you will look into alpha by 2. So you are fixing alpha. So this is important here. Write your alpha or alpha by 2 based on your alternative hypothesis. And from the table, you select the value. This is called as table value. You will use the respective table. Here we'll be using what called as t tables. Present for almost all the continuous cases, the probabilities, and they are all, you know, tabularized. We'll just use that particular table in order to obtain that. So if my t cal is less than minus k or greater than plus k, then I'll reject the hypothesis. So I have plus k as well as a minus k because it is a two-day alternative or two-day test. So this is the test procedure. Now the procedure of 2 is also similar to what we have discussed in case of Z test. So there we write mu 1 is equal to mu 2, mu 1 minus mu 2 less than 0, greater than 0, not equal to 0, or a particular value, say theta. But the test statistic gets a simplified form. So we will look into the problem on this. Mark this as important. One problem for 10 to 15 marks will be there in the examination. But in the second case, only the procedure could be asked. Test for equality of two population means there, I'll just write the hypothesis. We are testing for mu 1 equals mu 2, or mu 1 minus mu 2 equals 0, or it could be theta in a special case. Mu 1 less than greater than not equal to mu 2, or mu 1 minus mu 2 less than greater than or not equal to theta. And the decision making is same whether it is one tail test, two tail test, etc. But in this case, in the two tail case, we will take alpha by 2. The test statistic. Test statistic takes a different form here. The statistic is t is equal to x1 bar minus x2 bar minus theta will be there if you are talking about theta. Otherwise, you can eliminate that, divided by square root of some s square into 1 by n1 plus 1 by n2. And this follows t distribution with alpha and n1 plus a2 minus 2 degrees of freedom. So here, degrees of freedom is n1 minus 1 as well as n2 minus 1 because we are talking about two samples. So the total becomes n1 plus n2 minus 2. And alpha is the level of significance. You can obtain the table value under this condition. So alpha or alpha by 2 for a two-tailed test. ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಮಾಡುವಾಗ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಹೆಂಗ ಆಲ್ಫಾ ಫಿಕ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದು, ಟೇಬಲ್ ವ್ಯಾಲ್ಯೂ ನೋಡೋದು ಹೆಂಗೆ ಅಂತ. ಸರ್, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಎಸ್ ಸ್ಕ್ವೇರ್, ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಎಸ್ ಸ್ಕ್ವೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಪೂಲ್ಡ್ ವೇರಿಯನ್ಸ್. ನಾವು ಸ್ಟಾಟಿಸ್ಟಿಕಲಿ ಸ್ಪೀಕಿಂಗ್, ಲಾರ್ಜರ್ ದ ನಂಬರ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವೇಷನ್ಸ್, ಮೋರ್ ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಶನ್ ರಿಗಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ದ ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲೇಷನ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಗ್ಯಾದರಿಂಗ್. ಸೊ ವಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಎನ್ ಒನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಎನ್ ಟು ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವೇಷನ್ ಟು ಗೆಟ್ ಅನ್ ಎಸ್ಟಿಮೇಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವೇರಿಯನ್ಸ್, ಅಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಅಸ್ ಪೂಲ್ ವೇರಿಯನ್ಸ್. ಅಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಬೈ n1 s1 square n2 s2 square divided by n1 plus n2 minus 2. So basically we are adding two variance there. That's s1 square is the variance calculated from first sample, s2 square is the variance calculated from the second sample. And now other things are same. So whether it is left tail test, how to take the decision, right tail test, how to take the decision, they are one and the same. So we have talked about four tests here. So remember all the four procedures. What are those? Two large sample cases, Z test for single population mean, Z test for equality of two population mean, then we talk about T test for single mean, T test for equality of two population mean. And out of these four cases, you look into the problems on T test for single population. So let me take you through some work examples here. So this is the second POC textbook. So we have this in chapter 6. It is a large and lengthy chapter. So first it talks about all those four Z tests, large sample test. Then they talk about T test. So these are the three different T tests what we are talking. And now we are looking into the very first case. Second case procedure is given. We'll talk about the procedure of third and problems on the third in the next class. So this is the procedure. So what we have an hypothetical value on mean that has to be proved, and the population is large. So since population is large, the variance is naturally unknown. So in that case, our X bar doesn't follow normal, it follows T distribution. So that's why we call this as T test. And for all the tests which are non-normal, like t-test or chi-square test, ANOVA, there exists what called as degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom simply tells you based on how many variables you are creating the distribution. So yesterday I said our Z is such that it can produce its own, you know, associated distributions called as t-distribution, chi-square distribution. T is one such distribution which is based on n chi-square variables. But here, my variable Z is constructed by using the sample variance, and that sample variance variance uses an estimate, which is our X bar. So what we have here is dependency exists between S and X bar. If you are actually using mu to compute the standard deviation, then the standard deviation will be different. So you can see here. So standard deviation is sigma xi minus x bar whole square by n. But our standard deviation is based on this x bar. X bar itself is an estimate. Using an estimate, we are obtaining the estimate of this. So we are losing independence there. So there is what called as independency, dependency, which are all, you know, mathematical concepts. So just understand or learn this. If you are working on several statistics, several estimates, but your estimate is using all an estimate, which is an estimate of sample, in that case, you will lose what called as degrees of freedom. And that you are in a situation, you are in a boundary, you're working well within the data. So you cannot, you know, give or you cannot gain more and more independence because you are working under the restriction of that sample. So sample has produced X bar, fine, you're using X bar, but using the X bar produced from the sample, you're talking about variance, then that variance is dependent on X bar, therefore you cannot independently use that. So you have to give some relaxation for that. So we are losing an independence there. So we are losing the degrees of freedom. So that is the essence. So you can, you know, look into some videos regarding degrees of freedom. What is n minus 1 degrees of freedom? Why n minus 1 when you're using mean? Can understand those things. Okay. So So this is the procedure. You will write the null hypothesis. So I have used theta on the right hand side. So we are using some number called as mu naught, and you can suspect any of these three cases. So you are selecting x bar s from the sample, and you are using, you'll come up with some number which we call as t calculated value, which is the result of this particular formula, and then you are comparing it with the table values. The table values are also, as said, tabularized similar to that of normal, but here you have to read it based on the degrees of freedom. And here degrees of freedom is n minus 1, alpha is known in the sense you are fixing, you are deciding what is the marginal error you want to commit in establishing this particular test to prove something. And usually we take our alpha to be 5%, 1%, can have tests with 10%, but very small the alpha, more accurate the degrees, more accurate the test will be. Okay, so understanding this with an example. Now the length of 10 sample cotton. Now whenever we are dealing with production industry, we cannot talk about population, because population items are nothing but all the items which you are producing. If you are using all the items to extract the data, to use how long they burn, etc., then there is nothing left to, you know, make profits and sales. So that's why we talk about samples, and we cannot afford large sample cases, because if I'm selecting large samples, like say if you want to test the life of tubelets, and if I'm checking more than 30, 40 tubelets in a production, then that is not, you know, really helpful in making or meeting my marginal profits there. So there are certain restrictions regarding the population, because of which we cannot take a large sample. So we are working under that constraint. Usually those are all economic constraints. So I have selected a sample which is 10 here, and that has a mean of 48 and standard deviation 3. So whatever the sample items, your x you have selected, from that you have computed mean 48, standard deviation 3. Now you are suspecting whether this sample is actually telling me that the population mean is 50 centimeter. So length of 10 samples of cotton taken from a population has mean length of 48 centimeter, standard deviation 3 centimeter. Test whether the mean length of the population can be taken as 50. So you are suspecting that my mean is equal to 50. So your alternative hypothesis is that it is not equal to 50. Why not equal to? Because nothing is telling you that mean is below 50 or mean is actually above 50. So that information is not known or not given. Therefore, we are taking mu not equal to 50. Now you have your research hypothesis with you, your objective. So that tells you whether you have to take less than, greater than, or not equal to form. So we'll look into one of the cases where we look into either less than or greater than cases. So this is the test now. So here everything is available readily, but that is need not be, you know, with respect to your examination, because the problems will be for 10 to 15 marks. So we will just give you x values. So now we will test here, do you have the knowledge of mean as well as standard deviation? Do you know how to compute mean and standard deviation? So some marks will be there for the calculations of mean and standard deviation from the sample. Is, you know, based on the formulas what we have studied. Since we are talking about x values, which is just raw data, x bar is sigma x by n, and standard deviation is, now there while teaching standard deviation, I use sigma. Now we are talking about what called a sample standard deviation, and we indicate it by s. The formula remains the same, sigma x square by n minus x bar whole square, or sigma x minus x bar whole square divided by n. So you have the value of n, you know x bar, you know s, and you know the suspected value of mu. You will substitute that in the formula of t. Why I'm using this t? Because my concern here is drawing one sample from a population, one sample of 10 units. Okay, 10 samples and 10 items na select maadidira anta artha.
other the mean matte other the standard deviation. So you are literally talking about only one population and one sample. Therefore, this problem comes under the category of t-test for single population mean. And here, since it is a PO book, we have given the level of significance, of course. But as said, it is always fixed. You will assume alpha equals 5% or 1%. But also look into what is given as the table value. Your table value will help you whether you have to take 5% or you have to take 1%. Whatever the decision you make, it is valid for all other particular alpha also. Like say, for any lower alpha, if you have rejected the hypothesis, even for higher alpha, you will always reject the hypothesis. So that's why we say fix alpha as low as possible. Now, after substituting these values of x bar, n, s in the test statistic, I have observed the value of t is minus 2. Now the question is this minus 2 actually lying in the rejection region or is it lying in the acceptance region? So I have to compare this with kn minus k. Why kn minus k? Because we have a two-tailed alternative. So these are important in order to obtain the table value. First, lay down your alpha, 5% or 1%. Degrees of freedom for all the t-tests for single mean is always n minus 1. What is n? N is the sample size. So you have selected 10 items. So degrees of freedom is 10 minus 1. And this is important, whether it is a one-tail test or two-tail test. So if it is two-tail test, now you have to actually divide alpha into two parts and give each for left tail as well as right tail. So you are looking into very low region compared to the region alpha, I mean probability of alpha. Okay, so this helps you in selecting the table value. And these are the table values obtained from the table. So I'll help you with this. So let us say that my values are this and my computed value is minus 2. So remember, what is the decision for a two-tail test? If your calculated value is below minus k or if it is above plus k, only then you will reject. So when you have the table value, you make a small graph like this. So you have k, you have minus k. So after k is your rejection region, that is RR, below k is your rejection region, but your observed value is 2, which is somewhere here, and your middle value of t is always 0, as t is close to standard normal distribution. So 2, now the minus 2, okay, so minus 2 comes here, which is above minus 2.26. So if you have observed a value like say minus 2.8, minus 4, minus 3, or a value like say 2.5, 3, 6, etc., then we say we will reject the hypothesis. But our value, calculated value is minus 2, which is in between these minus k and plus k, which is our acceptance region. Therefore, we say we are not rejecting the null hypothesis, but we are accepting. So what is this telling you is that whatever the sample you have selected, that sample has come from a population whose mean is 50. Why did we take it as 50? Why not 51? Why not 55? Because you know this from the past experience. My machine is set such that it produces 50 centimeter long handkerchief or a particular clothing or a particular cotton roll. So I know this. So I'm testing whether my machine is actually working. So has it gone below the specifications? Is it, you know, actually giving, you know, anything less or anything more than the desired result? Because I should be concerned, right? If the machine is producing anything below, well, the customers will sue me, so I lose the good hope. And if the machine is producing anything significantly larger than 50, then I'll be, you know, facing the losses. So every now and then I have to check whether my machine is working or actually producing the length which is significantly very much closer to 50. And my samples are telling that yes, your machine is working correctly, so your mean length is actually 50. So though you are observing x bar as 48, that is only because of this sample, but in reality your mean is equal to 50. So this is the procedure. Now, problems regarding the other cases, like say null, one tail, right or left tail, they're also same. So let me see if I have a test here. Yes. So this is a problem, maybe, you know, almost related to your subject. It is required to test whether those who practice yoga have an average blood sugar less than 120. A sample consisting of 17 persons who practice yoga is observed. And if their mean blood pressure is 108 and standard deviation is 8, what would you conclude? Okay, so you have a notion, or your past experience is telling that for all practice yoga or some exercise, their blood sugar level must be actually below 120. So this is your established statement, or this is what you have observed till now. But something is telling you that it is gone below now. So you have to prove whether this is actually the situation, or you have to disprove this statement. So we actually, hypothesis testing are already also, you know, constructed such a way that you produce enough evidence to test for the rejection of null hypothesis. We always test for rejection. That's why in most of the books you can say reject or do not reject. They don't talk about accepting at all. They talk about not reject. Accept and the hell alone, not reject and the hell. But you know, in most of the, you know, practical cases, they almost come to be same only. So to, in order to prove or disprove the statement, I have gathered the data from 17 persons. So I have randomly selected 17 persons. I have recorded their blood sugars levels, and I have obtained the mean, and I have observed mean as 108 and standard deviation has come to be 8. So now I apply the same test statistic, but if you look into the alternative hypothesis, my hypothesis is that we have to observe a blood sugar as 120. So 120 is the maximum limit for those who practice yoga or any sort of exercise. So you can come up with this number. So you know very well whether it is 120 or 125 or 130, because you have past data which is helping you what should be that limit. So this is how the limits are also obtained. So you'll do some, you know, lot of investigations, lot of trials by selecting large samples, and you have come up with a number 120. So you can have the question, why the normal blood pressure is 80 bar 120? Because that is normal. Why normal? Most of the people, most of the blood pressures what you have recorded, their mean actually comes to 80 bar 120. That's why we have fixed 80 bar 120 as the standard value. So there is certain notion, or, you know, certain things which, you know, are medically and practically proved. So that is giving you the value of mu. So we're using this 120 as value of mu. And now I have the value of n, which is 17, x bar, which is 108, and standard deviation 8. You fix whether you'll use 5% or 1%. Accordingly, you will get the table value. And in the exam, whether you conduct the test for 5% or 1%, you will be given marks, because accordingly, correctly, you will be doing. And as said, whether it is, you know, 1% or 5%, in most of the cases, the decision will be same. Whenever you are doing a test in very low alpha, the test will be true for very high alpha, but the vice versa is not true. There could be a case where in 5% you will reject, but in 1% you may accept. So that happens rarely, and, you know, most frequently in the medical field. So you should be careful what your alpha is. So since I'm suspecting that my mu should be below 120, that is my alternative hypothesis. So this is the test statistic, the same what we used in the previous case. So I'll substitute x bar minus mu and s by root n minus 1, and observing the value as minus 6. Now, one thing in t-test is that if you are observing really a high value or a low value, like say minus 5, minus 6, even for that matter 4, naturally will, you know, reject the hypothesis, because we see that our standard normal always lies between minus 3 and plus 3. So most of the observed values should be within minus 3 and plus 3, and almost even in the t case, t is slightly, you know, larger than z. So I could say minus 4 plus 4, but definitely not beyond that. but I cannot just take the cost.